Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Jesus Christ, our Lord, make us worthy to remember the faithful departed who profess their faith in you, and receive your body and blood as nourishment and blessings. Grant them rest, and may they share in your eternal banquet with your and your everlasting joy. Count them among your chosen ones, and may they raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, forever.
Amen.
Peace be with the church and her children.
Thank you.
ascended into the realm of the dead, bringing in life and resurrection. We ask you to accept the fragrance of our incense and our prayers. Place at your right hand the departed who believe in you and give them rest in your glorious dwelling, that with the living that they may worship you, glorify your divinity and thank you, your Father and your Holy Spirit forever.
Praise be to God always.
Amen.
Died among
In this chapter 16, our Lord famously gives us the teachings that you cannot serve God and mammon. We know this phrase. This chapter and this parable specifically is proper to St. Luke. It only appears in one of the four Gospels. Other aspects of the teaching of this chapter, they appear in little scattered references and images. They're there in St. Matthew. What our Lord's main purpose in this chapter 16 is to remind us that the attachment to riches, the attachment to wealth in general, makes us deaf to salvation. That's what this parable is actually telling us. So that in the first part of chapter 16, and as always, I recommend that one moment, somewhere either in pre-game or in post-game, when there's too many commercials, do try to read chapter 16 of St. Luke. Not that long. Or break it up. Do it in one section of commercials and then another section of commercials. But our Lord begins by teaching about this attachment to mammon. Now, it's interesting that in the Gospels we usually retain this word mammon, mammon, in Aramaic. Oftentimes in the modern translations, you'll see it translated as riches, but it's not really the question of money. Mammon in Aramaic means increase. It literally means profit, we would say. And money has this deceptive aspect, or wealth has the deceptive aspect. You can always add another dollar onto it. If I only made $10,000 more a year, things would be so much more peaceful at home. But doubtless, when I make the 10,000, well, maybe it should have been 15,000. Then things would be peaceful at home. You can always add something to it. And so it has a quasi-infinity to it, which makes it attractive more, and it gives us the ability to do things. But wealth is not the problem. The problem is the attachment to the increase, mammon, always wanting more, newer kitchen, bigger pool, newer car. We like sparkly things. We like them as children. We like them as adults. And so what our Lord says is because of that deceptive, seductive aspect, you cannot serve God. The purpose of your life cannot be fundamentally God and fundamentally the desire for increase. You cannot serve God and mammon. That's the first section of chapter 16. And the second part, when our Lord goes on further in the question of teaching and detachment, what our Lord is doing in this chapter is twofold. One, he's rejecting the desire for money, the love for wealth. That's clear. And St. Paul will actually quote it in his letters, and I have it quoted in the bulletin this week. When he writes to Timothy and he says that the desire for riches is the source of all evil, that's a pretty strong statement to make. He doesn't say wealth, he doesn't say riches. It's the desire for riches which is the source of all evil, the things that we will do to have something better. And it's not even a question of being rich or poor. Poor people can be just as avaricious as somebody who is a billionaire. It's the question of the attachment of our hearts, which is why in the Gospel of St. Matthew, our Lord says that there where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. What do we love? What are we attached to? And what are we looking for? But as I mentioned, what our Lord is trying to do in this chapter is twofold. One has to do with the question that we cannot make the fundamental aspect of our life to pursue mammon, to pursue increase. But the second part is our Lord is radically overturning the whole Old Testament view. When you read the prophets, when you read the old law, one of the things that God did for the benefit of the people of Israel and to teach them was, follow me, be obedient to what is being taught to you, and I will give you wealth and well-being. Now, we all have seen televangelists. They get up there, they walk around, they wave their arms, tell you about hellfire, and then tell you that if you follow Jesus, he wants you to be rich.
So if you send us $1,000 tonight, Jesus will make you rich. Now, where are the Protestants getting this from? Well, in a sense, fundamentally, it's in the Old Testament. Because God says, if you are faithful to me, this will be your land, and the land will prosper, and you will be prosperous and successful. You will have what you need. So with our Lord, what he's doing here is twofold. The first is talking about the detachment, but he's also saying that wealth is not the indication of your moral value. And that would have been shocking to everyone listening to our Lord. Because, as we said, the prophets talk about well-being and wealth as a sign that you are being faithful. Now, living in Puritan America, we have this culturally within our bloodstreams. Because the Puritans, as good Calvinists, were fundamentally directed toward the Old Testament. And wealth and merchandising and success in your business was a sign in Calvinism of your predestination to heaven. It is in our blood. The poor have a moral sense of being horrible and cursed in some way, and the rich, by being rich in some way, are lauded and have celebrity. That is radically found already back in the 17th and the 16th century in the foundation of our republic, because they came with their Calvinism. But that is not the doctrine of our Lord. The doctrine of our Lord is the fact that moral goodness is in fidelity to the teaching of our Lord has nothing to do with worldly wealth or poverty. Now you understand why this leads immediately into this parable. But we said the lesson of the whole chapter is that this wealth, and specifically the attachment to wealth, is what makes us deaf. We cannot hear. So now you look at the parable, we finish with that. Now you can see the parable has a different light. This rich man who eats every day and dresses well and has everything you possibly need is not even aware or attentive or is ignoring the man who is at the door of his house who just begs in the streets. He is deaf to the voice of his fellow human beings first, and ultimately he is deaf to God. Why this attachment? St. Paul says the desire for riches is the source of all evil. It makes us unable to hear. And so we're told immediately they both died. And the one, we're told that the poor man was obviously a good man because he finds himself with Abraham. And the notion of death is the Semitic notion, Sheol. They both die, and when the rich man dies, he goes to Sheol, he goes to Hades, he goes to the lower world, waiting the day of judgment. And in this state, he has torment waiting for this day of judgment. There's anxiousness, there is despair, there is frustration, there is fear. Which is why in the parable, our Lord says they communicate by talking. This man from his torment calls upon Abraham. Abraham is part of the image of the dead of the Old Testament who are good. That is the place where our Lord dies in his justice, in his holiness, that he descends into hell. In our creed, when we say this, he descended into hell. He descends into Sheol. He descends into the lower world. And the presence of Abraham is the figure of the promise, the one who is faithful to God, who has walked before God in belief, but having no idea where it's taking him. And so Abraham's bosom, we also call this, the presence of Abraham. It's the place, it's not heaven, but it's the place where the morally just, the good, were before the day of our Lord's death and resurrection. You notice that in the whole parable, the poor man doesn't say anything. He never talks. He's just a good man who had suffered much in this world. And then you have this back and forth in the parable with the rich man. Send Lazarus at least to come and help me. Not bring me a cup of water. I'm not even asking a lot. Just dip his finger, the tip of his finger into water. Something to alleviate my pain. And Abraham just answers, we can't, because the chasm and the chaos between us doesn't allow any communication between the two. Now, if you look at the icon that's on the front of the bulletin of Father Badawi, you'll see that the deceased person is on a ship, he's in a boat, and he's traversing fire. Now, some of you will be screwed up because I was talking while I was printing the bulletin, and so it's actually black and white. It was meant to be color, I wasn't paying attention. But it's all red, it's fire, not the fire of hell. He's not traversing hell, it's this passage from this world to the next. And you'll notice that what he has in front of him is an altar that has the Blessed Eucharist on it. Because it's receiving the body of our Lord and receiving his blood, which transforms us interiorly to not allow the flames of hell and of this chaos to touch us. That's what he's portraying in the icon. So Abraham makes reference in this Semitic vision to this chaos that separates the just and the unjust in Sheol. And so the last recommendation and our last point is that he says, all right, well, if Lazarus can't come to me, have him go to my family's house, because I've got brothers who are just as stupid as I am. And so they don't have to come to this place of torment. So if Lazarus went to see them, they would know, and they would repent, he says. They would change the way they thought. They would change the way they act, and they wouldn't come here. And Abraham gives, and this is why we say this attachment which makes us deaf. Abraham's answer is, they have everything they need already now. They have Moses, they have the prophets, they have the teaching of God, let them listen. And the reaction of the rich man is, no, Abraham, Father Abraham, this is not the way it will work. But if someone came back from the grave, they would believe. And that magnificent answer at the end of the parable. If they will not listen to their catechism, if they do not follow the faith which they know abstractly, then they would not believe even if one rises from the dead. It's the end of chapter 16. But our Lord is giving in this parable to remind us, the living, something I mean to do with the dead, us, the living, to open our ears and to detach ourselves from the things of this earth. St. Paul will later on say, use them as if not possessing them. We can have them, they're not evil. But it's the effects upon us which become and can become evil as we attach ourselves to them. And our Lord is doing two things at the end of this parable. Not only bringing a summation and an example by parable of all that he's taught in the chapter, but he's also telling the Jews and everyone else who's standing around and listening, they have Moses and the prophets, and they will not believe even if one rises from the dead. He's preparing. This is chapter 16 of St. Luke. We're more than halfway through the gospel. We're preparing for the passion of our Lord, this confrontation in which those who do not like what he is teaching will put him to death. They have Moses and they have the prophets. And if they do not hear them, they will not believe even if one rises from the dead. He's already laying out what's going to happen to those people who are around him already, that even when he rises from the dead, they will still remain hardened and they still remain deaf to salvation. So may our Lord grant us the patience, the light, the wisdom, and the humility to use these gifts of God from his great love as if not possessing them, they're on loan, and granting us the wisdom to use them as not using them, and in that path of wisdom to remain, to listen to the voice of God in our lives, and by doing so to receive that salvation and well-being which only grace and give. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
We believe in one.
Thank you. 856, in Aphorism.
In Aphorism 66, on page 856. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Holy Father, grant security, peace, and everlasting love to your church, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace to you, holy altar of God. Peace to the holy mysteries placed upon you. Peace to you, O minister of God.
Let each one of us give a greeting of peace to his neighbor with love and faith, which is pleasing to the Lord.
Thank you.
May they guide your church and present to you a faithful people who honor your name. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Lord, reward those who do good. Free those bound by hardships. Liberate the poor and visit those who are dejected, distressed, and weary. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Lord, be a fortification for every city and country that truly believes in you and takes refuge in you. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, to pacify the wounded communities and strife among our people. Shed your compassion and grace upon them all, so that your light and guidance may bring them to overcome ignorance and hatred. May your divine charity bring them all into the fullness of your kingdom. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Lord, strengthen those who call upon the mother of your Son, Jesus Christ, and the saints who have pleased you, especially St. Joseph, St. Mary, St. Jude, St. Charbel. Through your grace, make us and our departed worthy of the eternal blessings that you have prepared for your saints. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O Lord, forgive the faithful departed who have been redeemed by the death of your only Son. And on that day when all are rescued from death, delivered from the realm of the dead, and raised from the dust of the grave, the grace of your only Son will have been glorified in us and in them. Through him we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Remember us, O Lord, that you departed, and forgive the sins we have committed, with the wrath of the Lord.
O Lord, in the resurrection on the last day, when all is renewed, make us and your faithful departed worthy through your grace of the joy of your heavenly kingdom. In us and in all things, may your blessed and most honored name be glorified, praised, and exalted, with the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was in heaven, shall be forever.
Power and glory.
Lord, hasten to transform all that is harmful and detrimental into that which will help and benefit us, that we may raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
Bow your heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, whose life to whom we partake of, and receive the blessing from the Lord.
O Lord, may your graces, your blessings, and all your divine gifts descend in abundance upon your church, your parishes, monasteries, and convents, that we may raise glory to you now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And
with
your spirit.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy with perfection, purity, and sanctity. One holy Father,
one holy Son, one holy Spirit. Blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever.
Make us worthy, O Lord.
Again and again we thank you, O Lord, and we raise glory to you, giving us your body to eat and your living blood to drink. O lover of all people, have mercy on us.
You shall walk.
become the food of the imperishable fire. We raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever. So I recommend that you take the bulletins, especially this week. You have a letter from Bishop Gregory concerning the annual Lenten appeal for the eparchy, which is set at $4,000. So if you don't give us $4,000, it's still going to be sent to him, so just know. But the letter is there. It explains how the money is divided up for the eparchial needs also. And you also have the announcement for this coming Friday is the Feast of St. Mary, so our Father in Christ, founder of our church. And so it's a holy day of obligation for all Maronites. And we're going to try the experiment of doing times. Like on Saturday and Sunday. The Sunday Mass we have 4 p.m. and we have Sunday morning at 10. Our days are supposed to be the evening before the morning, not in the morning and in the evening of the same day, like the Latins do. Because our day begins at sundown, like the Jews have always done. And so the Mass of St. Mary will be on a Thursday evening at 6 p.m. and at 9 a.m. is the usual time on Friday morning. So we'll see if we do well with this experiment. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishments and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.